Meet the Press with Hugh Remington.
Hello and welcome to Meet the Press. It's not even a week since Julia Gillard's victory over Kevin Rudd in the leadership ballot. That endorsement left her impatient, she said, to get on with it, with not a day to lose.
I intend to be a very forceful advocate of the government's policies, so settle in. Any other questions? Thanks very much.
But almost immediately, she was caught in a messy tangle over whether former New South Wales Premier Bob Carr had been offered the Foreign Minister job, vacated by Kevin Rudd, and coveted by Defence Minister Stephen Smith.
I've just said completely untrue.
Well, what do you know?
When the distinctive voice of Prime Minister Gillard rouses you from your slumber and says, will you be Foreign Minister of Australia? I couldn't have found it in me to have said no.
Friday morning, Tony Abbott was busy condemning the Prime Minister for not hiring Bob Carr.
Very, very clear case of Julia Gillard being stood over by Stephen Smith.
By Friday afternoon, he was condemning her for signing him on.
It never makes sense to tell lies to the Australian people. Every time this Prime Minister says that something is completely untrue, you know it is true.
But Julia Gillard believes she has made a choice who will live up to her threat earlier in the week.
Whoever I select won't break into a sweat wiping the floor with her.
Her reshuffle punishes Rudd backer Robert McClelland and leaves Stephen Smith in his second choice of portfolio of defence.
There are no entitlements in public life. I don't have any entitlement to be disappointed.
Smith and Carr must now work together on thorny strategic challenges, not least a respectable endgame in Afghanistan.
When the Canadian and Dutch troops have been brought home, we Greens want to see our Australian troops brought home to this country.
Greens leader Senator Bob Brown is our guest. And later, one of the country's leading strategic analysts, Professor Hugh White from ANU and the Lowy Institute. But first, here's Hermione Kitson with what's making news this Sunday, March the 4th.
Thanks, Hugh. Good morning. A man is still missing in southern New South Wales after his four-wheel drive was caught in floodwaters near Goulburn. West of Sydney, overnight falls have put more pressure on the river system and 2,000 people have been ordered to evacuate. Hundreds of properties have been vacated across the state as heavy rain continues. Victorian Premier Ted Baillieu were to a flood-affected parts of the state today as rising waters continue to threaten towns in the northeast. Flash flooding and gale-force winds have battered some areas and the army's been called in to help SES crews protect homes. And powerful tornadoes have killed at least 35 people in the southern United States. The fast-moving twisters flattened homes and left extensive damage as they swept across four states, virtually wiping out some towns. Authorities are warning residents there could be worse to come as the tornado season progresses. And those are the headlines this morning. Hugh?
Hermione, thank you, and welcome to the program, Greens leader Bob Brown. Good morning, Senator.
Good morning, Hugh.
Now, have you had a win in your battle against the hate media?
Well, I think the Australian people are being given a very good recommendation by the proposal for a news media council coming out of the Finkelstein report. And contrary to the reaction from the media, certainly the opinion columns today, this council's simply there to, when people get defamed, when there's mistakes made in the media, to see that they're corrected very quickly. You'd swear there was a government takeover of the media. There isn't. There will be an arm's length. It'll be paid for by the taxpayers. News Media Council, which simply looks at the news and makes sure it's gotten right, because people get hurt when it's not right. It's in the public interest, and all it says is that it will uphold the journalist's own code of ethics. I don't know what the the journalists who are crying about this are worried about, because it will really raise the level of journalism and reward people who do the right thing.
Are you entitled to claim credit for this?
We stood a pretty big barrage of criticism from particularly the Murdoch media in moving for a media inquiry in Australia. But it was the right thing to do because it's in the public interest.
So why has this system, the recommendation now is for a government-funded body, why will that work when the industry bodies, in your view, have not?
Well, not in my view, but in the view of this review by Mr. Finkelstein, because the current media watchdog, well, it's in two parts. It's one for TV and other media, and it's one for the press. What this report says, let's have one that covers everything from online media right through to the press, and make sure that if somebody's defamed, if there's a mistake, it's fixed up within a few days. It's not punitive, there's no jail sentences, there's no fines. It's a very reasonable upholding of the Australian journalist's own code of ethics. What could be wrong with that? The other difference is, instead of there being an opt-out, as there is with the current press council, it's funded by the Murdoch media, the Fairfax media, and some other outlets, but you can opt out of that any time you want. It will be publicly funded and at arm's length. So it's a very good, sensible, down-to-earth, reasonable proposal.
Do you think it'll pass into law?
It should do. We want to see the government act on this. It's been a very thoroughgoing inquiry. There were a lot of public submissions calling for a lot more, but the Finkelstein outcome, I think, is very moderate. It's very restrained, and it's a good one because, again, it simply upholds the journalist's own code of ethics. That's pretty fair go.
Now, in 2010, in the minority government arrangements that followed during the negotiation phase, you got meetings, a meeting once a week with the Prime Minister. You pulled out of that in January. Was that now a mistake?
Well, I did in December, Hugh. I told the Prime Minister with a Christmas break coming up that because she hadn't upheld her signature on the forest agreement in Tasmania, which was going to put $272 million into getting loggers who face bankruptcy out of the industry and into other productive pursuits and some regional development, all of which I'm in favour of. On the other hand, logging was to stop in the World Heritage Value forests, which were facing logging, but that didn't stop. Forestry Tasmania sent the bulldozers in, and it's ripping into those very forests right now.
So you stopped the meetings?
I said the regular meetings can halt now. I will talk to you on any issue that's of national importance.
Was that a mistake? Are you going back to the regular meetings?
I'm going back to the regular meetings. I spoke to the Prime Minister about that during the week, and I'll resume those with Adam Bandt when Parliament resumes.
Why? Why are you going back to it if you dumped it?
Because we are getting into some very big issues. We've got the mining tax. We're looking at the solar rebate scheme, which the government's dumped without consulting with us. We've got a big budget coming up. We've got the media inquiry, and it's simply made no difference as far as protecting those forests are concerned. I have to find another mechanism for trying to protect Australia's environment through the Greens, who are the champions of the environment. But I've changed that because it's in the public interest to do so. And, that's always what comes first, as far as I'm concerned. If it's in the public interest, then you have to change a decision you made. But I am appalled by what's happening to that forest agreement in Tasmania.
OK, well, we'll be back with the panel. We'll pick up on some of those issues, including the solar hot water rebate, in just a moment. Now, retiring Senator Mark Abib says we all know now why he resigned from Parliament. He's going back to Summer Bay. Now, in case you missed the reference, that is the home of Home and Away, the other soap opera that once attracted his talents. And there he is, with hair, and appropriately in the red.